so much for coming, and welcome to EXPO Chicago. My name is Stephanie Gristello. I'm the Director of Programming here, as well as the Editor-in-Chief of The Scene, Chicago's International Journal of Contemporary and Modern Art. It is our distinct pleasure to welcome you today to the second annual symposium, which is focused on art and architecture this year. And it is our pleasure to be producing this panel in collaboration with the Chicago Architecture Biennial, in partnership with Sharon Johnston and Marklee of Johnston Marklee, the co-artistic directors of Make New History, which is the 2017 edition of the biennial. Today the panel will be featuring a series of artists and architects featured in the biennial, moderated by Jesús, featuring Luisa Lambri, who is represented by Luhring, Augustine, Thomas Diemond, represented by Matthew Marks Gallery, as well as Florian, Idenburg, and Adam Caruso. Please join me in welcoming our panelists. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stephanie. So my name is Jesús, Vassallo. I would like first, of course, to thank the directors of the biennial, Marklee and Sharon Johnston, also the director of the of EXPO, and all the staff working here in the fair for making this possible. I guess the reason why I'm here is because I was deemed to be a good moderator for a conversation between architects and artists. I'm an architect by training, but I write about architecture and photography. I know this is sort of the focus of my most recent work. And I'm also participating in the biennial as curating a small show of photography. It's titled A Love of the World, and it includes artists such as Luisa Lambri, who is here with us today, as well as Jim Welling, Veronica Kellendorfer, Marianne Mueller, Scott Fortino, David Shaliol, Katharina Gensler, Daniel Everett, and Philippe Scherer. So it's quite a big show that you can see mostly in the Cultural Center in the Biennial, which opens to the general public tomorrow. So the reason why I bring up this show, other than just for pure self-promotion, is because in my mind, the thread that pulls the work of the artists together, that sort of makes them fit within the Biennial, is is the idea that they share a certain understanding of realism and abstraction as not completely opposing concepts, but rather a sort of dialectical pose between which that helped them articulate the process or their work. You know, and I think that I think this is especially true of our panelists here today. And I think it's basically my proposition is for us, you know, or for the panelists to present their work sort of according to these. To this line. And I think maybe in the case of architecture, abstraction is something that is a given, and there happens to be a kind of architect that also feels sort of a realist impulse, which I think, and then maybe in the case of photography, for instance, maybe realism is a given, and there's a certain type of artist or photographer that sort of has an abstracting impulse. And I think the four people who are here today, which, by the way, is a great honor for me to be able to share the stage with them, are really interesting cases to look at that problem. So, without much more wasting our time, I'd like to invite the four panelists to briefly talk about their work within that context, and then we'll open up the conversation for the panel and the audience. Would you mind starting, Florian? I believe this is the
clicker. Let's see, I think. Okay, thank you for inviting me to be on this panel. I thought it would be most productive to look at certain ways of representation that we have in our work. I won't speak a lot about the work itself, but more the way we use different media to represent it. We're an office in Brooklyn. We work a lot within the field of the arts, and that's maybe what I will say with regards to the type of work we do. I thought today it would be good to look at a few things, and so I have three types of media, basically, to look at. One is photography, the other is render and representation, and the last is video, and I will show very quickly a few of those and speak maybe about an attitude that we have with regards to this. And I think there's a lot of architects that maybe have a very strong sort of single relationship with one photographer, and maybe have a very distinct style, but I think we are a little bit more free and experiment with different photographers and different ways of representing. And so I wanted to show one, let's see. Yeah. So this is a very early project we worked on a mice and display case where we had to show mice and porcelain. And it is about sort of editing and filtering out some of the details, or some of the idea of the object, so that certain details become very clear. We worked with sculptors of a nest in a very sort of abstract way in which they documented this very geometric forms. And so here, I think we, both the architecture or the architectural intervention, as well as the representation of it, make the piece more abstract, possibly, than its actual experience. And I have Luisa Lambri's photograph in here, and maybe she also has been her show later, but we worked, I know Luisa for a very long time, and we've worked together before in Japan, and recently she came and was so kind to document the museum we recently completed at the University of California, Davis, which deals a lot with light and shadow, where we wanted to have the presence of light really be experience, and I think in Luisa's work there's a very strong ability to show that. But then we also work with somebody like Iwan Ban, and Iwan Ban is a very different type of photographer, somebody who actually really in some way shows the reality of the world, shows all life that happens around our buildings, and we work with him as well. And this image particularly is interesting because it's very abstract, yet there is sort of a hyper-real set of figures in there, and some people ask, so when are you actually building the building? Because people feel that this is a rendering, and some of his work is almost so hyper-real, if you want, that people feel it's a render. So that's a few of the photography that we work with. And then if you think of projects that haven't been built, then the question comes of representation, and how do you actually show these renders. This is and what we try to do here is maybe sort of a different strategy where we try to introduce this idea of a narrative or a certain type of suspense. So this is a triptych we made for an arts organization. We're doing three buildings in Bushwick. And so these are renders, but we render a certain, you know, reality in it. So the exit sign or the ladder or the rail where the paintings will hang, things that you normally would actually eliminate out of these representations and bring their idea to have some sort of idea of a narrative, maybe that people can start to imagine themselves. Very similarly, for a series of three objects we're making for Noel, the future of the workspace, we make this a very hyper-real, sort of dense renders with a lot of objects that allude to certain things. So one example here is the House Hooker mind expander that speaks about the presence of the virtual in our work space, and a robot that will replace us as worker, and they're the confetti for the farewell party of the last human in our workspace. So these are images in a way where you can depict full narratives and figure things out. And then I will end with one video for a project which is an extension of a museum, where we actually try to play a sort of game between the model, the representation of the model, the virtual, so the physical and the virtual. And so there's sort of a hybrid between virtual and a physical that we try to represent in there. So we'll play it, it's 2 minutes, and then let's see if it will work. So can somebody do play? And there should be some sound with this here.
film. Drive a GTO, wear a uniform, a lot of government loan. I'm worth a million in prizes. Yeah, I'm through with sleeping on the sidewalk. No more beating my brains. No more beating my brains. I'm really never in drugs. I'm really never in drugs. Well, I'm just a modern guy.
There was a wonderful presentation, a very sort of illuminating explanation of how images play out in your work and some different roles that the image and the production of images can have within your practice. Also, I sort of failed to introduce you properly, but you did a great job yourself of presenting the work and the work of your film So Real, which you founded in 2008 with Jing Liu, and it has produced an amazing quantity and quality of work in a very short period of time. It's just been very impressive. So allow me to introduce Luisa, an Italian artist born in 1969 and currently based in Milan, previously in Los Angeles, who studied in the University of Milan and received her PhD from the Department of Visual Arts, Music and Theater of the University of Bologna, and where she wrote her thesis on the work of Cindy Sherman. And it's also, you mentioned it already, Florian, but the fact that the two of you met in Japan, I believe you were working for the architects Caruso and in the firm Sana, basically in 2008, and then it was on the occasion of Luisa photographing the architecture of Sana that you first got to meet each other and have remained in touch. Would you like to present? Mm-hmm.
So my work is more quiet, so I'll.
No Iggy Pop music.
No
Stooges.
Okay. I just show some images as if they were part of the same series, really. So I have a very personal relationship with architecture. I take photographs of architecture, but not because the buildings were built by a particular architect or because I have a particular understanding of architecture, but just because of my emotional connection to the buildings, really. And I just use architecture or spaces to make photographs and images rather than using photography to document architecture. So that's basically what I've been doing over the last couple of years. And I usually take photographs of houses. So these are all details of kind of really iconic, famous houses, but I just focus on little details and really work with them. And use the architecture so that it looks more like myself, basically. I just use spaces and architecture as a mirror or as windows and not so much for what it really is. So I feel very free to use it and work with it and just make it my own through photography and images. I've not only photographed architecture and houses in particular, but also works by other artists I feel related to. Just the same way I feel related to architecture in some kind of way, I feel a connection with other artists' works. And in this case, for example, I photographed Donald Judd in Marfa, and in the same way I would photograph the interior of a house. So I actually literally went inside his sculptures and photographed them as a space. Or this is a smaller kind of space. This is a small beach by Ligia Clark. And I really played with it and really made it my own work. So, and this is Barbara Hepworth work in St. Ives. And this is a sculpture which is supposed to be walked through. So it was sort of an ideal environment for me to be in. And this is another kind of a well-known building, and again a detail, a well-known detail of a very well-known building. And I photographed it, and I took the actual view away and just made it white. And so really there's no wish or no need or no intention to document, really, but very much a wish to use space to really make it my own, to really make it so that it's a portrait more of myself than of the buildings. But I know what they are, and I use them for what they are. So I always really usually focus on kind of meaningful details of the architecture. It's more important for me to use these places and almost move there through images. So this house is really somehow become my own. And so this is the Farnsworth House in Chicago, which is shown at the Cultural Center for the Biennial. This is also the Farnsworth House. So I really spend time in these places, but also kind of empty them. And to take furniture away, either literally or at the lab after the shooting, and then I just really change. I really change the place so that they have their own. The images can have their more independent life, and they can exist independently of the buildings where they come from. So this is Crown Hall again. And that's it.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much, Luisa. Before we move on to just a short question, because I think it's interesting that you say that you don't photograph a building for necessarily because of the fame of the architect or the relevance of the building, but rather because you're trying to project something else. But there is a, even though the photographs are very highly abstracted, there is still the possibility to recognize the building, like you said, for instance, with the Whitney or with the Farnsworth. And I wonder, to what extent do you regard your work as a certain sort of commentary, or whether you're trying to basically somehow project the possibility of a different architecture, just based on an existing work?
I know very well what kind of places these are. That's why I go there, and I select them myself. So I sometimes have suggestions or proposals, but I really usually choose them for what they are. And these are places or works of art I really identify with. So really there's a kind of emotional connection, and they speak for me in some ways. So, but at the same time, I really look at them with a lot of respect, and I am aware of what they are, but I try also not to know too much about them, so that I can really, so that I can avoid a kind of understanding be in the way of being there.
So in order to be able to produce a more free reading of the...
Exactly. It's more about being able to be somewhere and feeling connected with the place and in touch with it and emotionally present. And so to be able to connect with it intuitively and so then I forget all the rest. And so, yeah.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Luisa. So our next panelist, Adam Caruso, is a Canadian architect, the founding partner of Caruso St. John, architects with offices in London and Zurich. He studied architecture at McGill University in Montreal, and worked for Florian Bagel and Arab Associates before establishing his own firm with Peter St. John in 1990. He has taught at the University of North London, the University of Bath, the Academy of Architecture, Matrician, the Graduate School of Design at Harvard University, and the Cities Program at the London School of Economics, among others. And he's currently a professor of architecture and construction at the ETH in Zurich.
Thank you. Made me sound a bit worthy there. Anyway, I'm going to show pairs of images. It's interesting what Luisa was saying about taking photographs in order to make the places hers. Maybe because I'm an architect, I try to do everything I can to make the buildings that we design in our office not have any kind of symmetrical relationship to me or our office. I think it's the difference between being an artist and an architect. And so our use of images, I would say, is one of the ways in which we attempt to make our work as anonymous and have as little to do with us as possible. Because I think if one makes work as an artist or as an architect, one cannot help but make the work one's own. You don't have to try it unless you're incredibly cynical. Maybe there are ways of making it so duplicit it isn't seeming to be yours. But I'm not cynical, I'm quite idealistic. And so I never think that one really needs to bother about how a work expresses oneself. And I think with architecture, where once you're finished, a project is out there in the real world, it's quite important to be conscious of that. And there's a lot of architecture which does have a kind of symmetrical relationship with its author. And in the most cases, that architecture is highly problematic to me. So I'm going to show pairs of images. Since we started our practice 27 years ago, Peter and I, we're very old architects now, we've always used images. And this is a very early work that we were very interested in just when we started. It's a photograph by, I don't have to say it because there's labels, by Lee Friedlander from the 60s. And we used photography, but also art, as a way of understanding the world around us, and also as a way of understanding how we can use the world around us. So for us, let's say photography in particular, is interesting conceptually because it tells us something about how we can engage with the concrete world. For instance, the work of Friedlander, or the work of German photographers of the Düsseldorf School. But we also use photography and other forms of art formally. We also use them to show us, to copy, basically. And so this kind of rhyming, conceptual rhyming, but maybe it's more interesting because it's seemingly even dumber, a formal rhyming is something which from our earliest work, and this Friedlander was used extensively to make this piece, which is a work from the first year of our practice. It was a competition entry which was completely sank without a trace. But nonetheless, it was an important thing for us to make, and it's clear how this facade is trying, with some small success only, I would say, to have the complexity, but also this kind of mirroring relationship to the context around it. It's another early piece. This is a Robert Ryman, a painting from 1970. There was a big Ryman show at the Tate in 91 or 92. I remember going to see it about three times, Peter going to see it the catalog being next to our desks, and us at the same time working on this project, which is this early studio house where we had our office, and there were explicit connections between the way, between the kind of way Ryman instrumentalizes material in his paintings, but also kind of this idea of a painter who only uses white, which isn't really true because there's lots of colors in his painting. It helped us a lot to make this project. And it's not just the facade that was informed by the Rhine. A reference that's kind of been a long-standing reference for us, photographs by Bertin Hille-Becker, particularly these series of industrial facades where they're just by directing their frame of their camera and using this kind of insistently typological method show you the incredible invention, often rather unconscious, that appears in these industrial buildings, and using that in our entry for what became Maxi in Rome, to try to make a new building that would have the directness of the industrial buildings that covered the site and that we kept more of than the eventual winner, Zahadi. Another favorite, and it, as you can see how eclectic we are in our interests, because we can look at industrial facades from the 20th century, but also early Renaissance work from the 15th century. So this is Alberti's facade for Santa Maria Novella, only a facade project that he made, kind of just beginning to make a classical architecture for churches. And our project to make a facade for the Museum of Childhood, a 19th century museum building in East London, which was never completed and which we completed in 2007. And really, we were directly looking at the technique, but also the kind of naive handling of classicism in the Albertian, trying to make a kind of minimalist, flat version of it in our project. Another Alberti reference, I guess I like Alberti a lot. This is his sepulcher for the Rucellai family, also mid-15th century. This was a much more intuitive reference. This beautiful marble sepulcher with these amazing inlays. And then we used it in the competition, which we won and we eventually built for the new chancel of the Cathedral of St. Gallen. So a new high altar for St. Gallen. And it's not an early Renaissance church, it's a Rococo church, but somehow the delicacy and the fragility of Alberti's early Renaissance architecture, we felt had a resonance with kind of vegetal themes of Rococo architecture. And the last pair, this is an office building by Hans Pulzig from the 20s in Hanover, but this idea of a northern German or a Hanseatic brick tradition. So these German architects looking at America and then making a kind of tough commercial architecture, which is still very European. And then a project we completed last year for a building in a Hanseatic city in Bremen, a new bank headquarters, where we really tried to make a facade, a whole building, but a facade especially on this very important place, with the same sensibility, the same material, and in some cases with the same techniques, but in many ways not the same techniques because we're, of course, 100 years later.
I think I especially appreciate the way that you describe the photography works, the way that you work with photography, which is a sort of twofold. In that, on the one hand, it allows you to relate to the environment around you, to read the interpret the world, and on the other, it's a sort of repository of formal also solutions. And I think that's a little bit what I was trying to get at with this idea that. The one hand is a realist impulse that in order for art or architecture to have some sort of social political meaning has to relate to something outside of itself. But on the other hand, there's always, in order to do that, it has to work through forms and through abstraction, the way that these two things mediate. And also, I would say, your presentation was a really precise take on the prompt that the biennial directors proposed as to how architects relate to history, which in many cases is through images. Also, it was a very, very precise way to demonstrate that. So thank you very much. And Thomas, our last panelist today is a German artist born in Munich in 1964, who currently works in Los Angeles and Berlin. He studied at the Academy of Fine Arts in Munich and the Kunst Academy in Düsseldorf, also briefly at Goldsmith College in London, and who currently holds professorship for sculpture at the University of Fine Arts in Hamburg. And it's also worth noting that Alan Caruso and Thomas Demand have known each other for a long time. They met in 2001 when the firm of Caruso St. John designed an exhibition for Demand at the Fondation Cartier in Paris, and they have continued to work together in many exhibition projects, but also other joint competition entries. And they are currently presenting a contribution in the Biennial, a room that they have produced in collaboration in the cultural center. So, Thomas, please.
I kind of worked with Caruso's for a long time, not in representing their buildings. I never done that. Well, so far I haven't done that yet, but like we worked on developing ideas in whatever form. So mostly in the beginning it was like I found myself in a very desirable exhibition space, which were unfortunately not very fitting to my own work, and I had to question whether I should actually change my work according to the building or not, and I decided not to, but find a moderating force between the architecture and me, which was in the Fondation Cartier, for the people which know it. The Fondation Cartier is basically a jewel box, like a Jean Nouvel built, a glass building, and it doesn't have a single wall. And so I needed somebody who can moderate between me and the, you know, the rhetorics of like rational architecture, which was in that case for what the purpose of the building is, were actually very unrational. So that's when they came into play, and we worked on other projects together, and four of them are in part of the architectural Biennale now, which I'm very happy to show in a way. I did a wallpaper, I showed two pictures, we discussed the whole setup, the photographs of buildings and the inspirational photographs in part of the exhibition, but it kind of, when you walk inside, you just see that it's a feedback circle where, yeah, you know, I got stuff from them, they got stuff from me, and just like, you know, it's an ideal collaboration for me, as far as I can tell from architects and artists, a give and take, and not a hierarchical kind of relationship at all. yeah, what else can I say? I think I only have one picture, in fact. No, I have a second one. This one is in the show as well. This is because the current holder of the presidency obviously is a builder himself, and I thought it would be very appropriate to bring that topic up in the architectural Biennale. A building is always a lot of correspondence, I can't say more. Everybody knows the story, I guess, for this one. You have another one? Oh, yeah, that's also in the show. That's the White House, the Oval Office, and it shows you that the presidency itself, so the institution of the role of the president, kind of gives you a halo by architecture, which comes in handy, I think. And I think that's my contribution to this. Yeah, I'd rather discuss. So thank you very much for inviting me. And
thank you. Thank you. Just to maybe to have you start the discussion. I've always been interested by remarks I've heard you say about the difference between architecture models and the way that you work with your physical constructs and your photography, that you see the objects that you make or you understand models in the sense that scientists do, as sort of building a sort of conceptual model, or as opposed to the way that architectural models are like miniatures or sort of represent. And I don't know if, I've always had the sense as an architect that for us, physical models are also testing grounds and sort of conceptual, even though sometimes we use them as a sort of last stage of a presentation for clients. That I don't know if, since there are many architects in the room, you would like to stand by your remarks. Right?
Well, two things. It's going in two directions. One is, I think, you know, in the current art history, like, there was something like the linguistic term, and there can be a iconic term, and I think we are about the cusp of like something about the model term or something, the modeling term, because people realize that our thinking and our digestion of a very complex environment like the world is today is highly reliable on a concept of modeling. You know, you just only have to think of the weather forecast for the hurricane, that obviously is a modeling of the environmental impact of a type of a hurricane on the coast. You get, you know, the retirement fund is based on models of how statistics in general are modeling tool. And so you find the modeling is actually really that what we do all the time. It's a filtering technique, technology to kind of understand where we are in the world and what we can do next and what we can't do next. And simulation comes into that play. Modeling models are very often simulation, using the technology of simulation, but not always. You know, like we have there's like a lot of scientific research has been done by understanding modeling by understanding bio models. If you think of what's in Crick, but also Linus Pauling and others, you know, like then now the whole scientific research, big data, is all based on reducing the complexity of the world to like what exactly you're looking for. And in architecture, it's very interesting because every bigger building project has been a model once when you look around. And there's something happening in architecture models where obviously there's a disruption between, which I find highly fascinating. That's why I think my affiliation with architecture is long ongoing now. Every building in Chicago was a model at some point. And in Chicago, it happens to be that most of the architecture is actually really great, but in the general feeling, if you go around in, I don't want to insult any other city, but like if you go around, there's a lot of mediocre architecture, which obviously was, as a model, once convincing to at least do the investment. And there's something happening which probably we all know, you just knee down, which is a gesture of like letting yourself down to the pedestrian level. Then you have an eye, which is probably in scale as big as like three London double-decker buses, which you look down up to a undetailed block of a building. But your encounter with a building, I saw that for instance with the photographs you showed, the encounter with the building you have is actually not about the facade and how great this line is going up. The encounter is with the door handle. Is it in the right place? Do I know where to get in? Do I know where to go? You know, how does it age? And all these things. So there's something really misleading in an architectural model. And you all know that because that's why you build other models for representation, then you build for the client, then you build for testing out things. And this kind of discrepancy I find very instructive for an artist because it just shows you how manipulative the model can be. And, you know, by definition, an artist is a manipulator. And so basically, that's why I feel drawn to the architectural representation of the world.
Thank you. I don't know how we're doing with time. I think it would probably be good to allow some questions from the audience. So I don't think we have it would be nice to stay here for another hour, but I'm afraid we just have a few minutes. I have these lights in my face, so.
Is there an audience, is the question, yeah.
So are there any questions from the audience?
Or however they are. So what the mechanics of it? You know, I use an iPhone 5. I have a Canon, a couple of Canon 35 millimeters, but what do you have? And would you share that? And how much of it do you job out or do you put hands on? I used to develop my own black and white. Tell us a little bit about it.
That's a wonderful, very precise question about technique. I think maybe you can just really say what camera you use. I think that would be enough probably.
I've been using one camera and one lens all my life. So I use a Mamiya 6x7 with one slight wide angle lens. And I don't have anything else. I don't like to have any technicality come in between my presence in the space. So the less I have, the better for me. I only use natural light. I'm kind of really bare. So as less as possible, I would say.
And I never studied photography, so I'm a bit of a amateur. I take whatever I can handle, from an 8 by 10 to like digital photography to iPhones. I don't really. That's not, you know, it's a photography for me is much more like an agreement between the viewer and the maker, and that you know how it's made and I know how it's made, and we can communicate through that technology. It's like. In that way, it's like a language or something. So if the photography gets too special or too much of an effect or too dominated by artifice, it becomes mute. Then it becomes, you know, something pretty or something. But like it, as long as it can communicate, and I only think it can communicate, as long as you keep that relation between the viewer and the maker very intact and very healthy, then it's interesting as a medium for me.
Thank you. More questions?
I think you're both builders. One building models, other one building buildings. And then there's one moment supreme where everything comes together, where the picture is taken or when the building is finished. How often do you look at the picture after it's been taken or revisit the building after it's built? And what does this mean, in a way, the other side of your profession? Tipping point.
I always found stories of, you hear stories that Arne Jacobsen, he used to visit his buildings every month, and he would correct all the mistakes that the clients made in his buildings. So he'd put the curtains in the right position, and he would do some cleaning, and he would get rid of the ugly furniture. I always thought, I could never understand that. To me, that's a kind of, I mean, it's obviously a nightmare architect, but also, why would you do that as an architect? I totally don't understand that. I mean, for me, building is a real big pain. It's very difficult. Some jobs are pleasurable, but it's a very small percentage of projects are pleasurable to build. So often you find yourself wondering, why are you bothering? A lot of the time I ask myself that question. And the only good answer I have is that actually, and we're total control freaks in terms of how we describe and control the construction of our projects. So at one level, when a project is finished, it's hopefully exactly what we expected. And quite a good percentage of our buildings, that's the case. But the magical thing is that there's then these other things which you were never aware of in the project. And that's, to me, other than the fact that you've done a useful building for someone, I mean, that's also, but it's not a huge motivation for me, actually. It's part of the social role of architecture. But that magic discovery that the building can be misused in a certain way, that's often really interesting, especially with an arts building, that the first show uses the major art gallery space in completely another way than you designed it for. And it actually, it works. And you see all this, that you see the building in a new light. And that's a reason to build, because you wouldn't have discovered that. And that knowledge you then take into the next project. But I hate the idea of, you know, some buildings you should do for people who you're friends with, and you revisit it, and mostly, and when they ask you, am I doing okay, are you doing okay, I always say, yeah, it's great, you know, do whatever you want, because it's not the architect's role to editorialize the life of clients.
And how do you respond to the same question, Thomas, because on the one hand, he said then that there must be something in the process of reconstructing these fragments of reality that you isolate that is necessary for you, so this sort of surprise of the process of making must be necessary. But on the other hand, as an artist, you could decide to show the construct, but you decide to only show them through photography. So on the other hand, there's no place for the user to in any way misinterpret, or I don't know if you'd like to answer that question.
Yeah, but the picture is what I send in the world, and that's what, you know, that's basically, the picture is a record of what happens in the studio. And I, as an artist who shows, you know, in the world, I have to handle my work again and again, and I, it's very difficult to give an honest but not pompous answer, because you just kind of, you look at the work, and sometimes you just realize that actually, you know, each of these works, in the end, you have like these doubts where you think, like, is this better or is that better? And for the outstanding person, there is absolutely no difference between the different versions. But for me, it's like the little thing over there was a mistake. Should I really done that or not? And stuff like that. And like 4 years later, you look at it and you don't even know why you, what the differences were, and why you just were like pondering for so long about like the smallest detail. And then they have their own life, and they go out, and you just, sometimes you see a very early work again, and you think, like, you know, it holds up well, and it's very nice to see it again. I have to say, but it kind of sounds a little self, you know, promotional.
You know, it makes sense that also the sort of the distance with the work, you know, makes us more forgiving, I think, to all of us, for sure.
Question here.
I have to say my brain is exploding right now, seeing Luisa and Thomas in the same room, and I can talk to you. It's pretty wild. I have a question about afterlives or revisitations. Have either of you, in Luisa's case, have you revisited the photographs in the sense of actually going back to the site and even trying the exercise of reproducing the original photograph that you did in your case? Thomas, have you actually tried to rebuild the model and then shoot it again? Or does the model just get destroyed? Thanks.
I have a very distant relationship with photography and architecture, and also with what I do. And I take photographs somewhere, and that's really just the beginning of my work. I would say most of it, if not whole of it, happens at the lab. So what you see here is doesn't have much to do with what actually happened when I was taking pictures. So my photographs are very, very different from the final result. And there's an endless potential there, because I'm really not after a perfect picture. My work, I feel more of a kind of a performance artist, where I spend time in the space and time, sometimes a very long time, and every photograph is equal to the next one. So there is no really, when I edit sort of really casually, and it's really more about trying to have a sort of a document that reflects myself in the space. And so that's the meaning of it for me. It's not so much about the architecture. And since I work so much with my printer, we dramatically change, really, the original image so much, and that really could go on forever. So I really has trouble actually finishing my work at the lab, or putting an end to a series, because for me there's no perfect picture. It's really just moments at the moment. And so it's really about time and being present and letting architecture speak for myself and reflect myself somewhere. So that's the sense of it. So it could be really endless images somehow.
And with me, is when I make a work, it's basically, I like to make most of what you, I mean, everything you see myself. I need assistance to do things like the general construction, because like it would take me half a year to do it. But in the end, what you look at and all the decision made on the photographs are done by me using my hands and doing it. And that kind of triggers a thought process, which I appreciate the most. And that's why I don't want to
actually give it to someone else, because then you're administering other people doing what you actually enjoy doing instead of, and I don't want to be a manager. That's why I became an artist. And so in the end, when I'm done with that thing, the photograph for me, very unlike Luisa, is that I'm trying to kind of basically have something like a window to what's standing in my studio. And I try to kind of make a photograph that shows it more or less in the sense I built it. And so you can see that when you stand in front, that's why it has a certain size as well. You stand in front of it, it looks like in a window into my studio. And so I try to kind of get then the photograph, also like I photograph way too many images until I have the right photograph, even if the lab which kind of develops my film says, like, you know, you can do this in Photoshop, but I actually can do it in reality, so I got to go back to the studio and I change it again and, until I have it really. And then I send this on and have, like, I try to kind of match what I was seeing on the light box as closely as I can. But, like, once that thought process is gone, there's no point in revisiting it, really. So, because that's like a ladder. I'm even on the next second floor, and now I know the first floor.
I have a question for Florian.
Yeah.
You said you're working with different photographers in your work, and working with different photographers, and there was one image, I think, from Iwan Ban, and in the sense that, I mean, often our work is not experienced directly, so as you're putting images out, I mean, you were talking about that gap between the image being sort of artificial or not appearing natural in relationship to the building. Is this, in the sense that you're working with different photographers, is this something that you're doing willfully, or it's sort of a luck of the draw?
No, I think, I mean, we've worked with Iwan from the beginning, and I think what I like about working with him is his work is very much concerned with the life around the building, basically, or how a building sits within its context. And I think maybe similar to Adam's work, I mean, we make these buildings to live within the world. And so showing this world and showing how the you know, people just overtake these buildings is something that I feel very strongly about. And I think Iwan is very interested in that as well. And so I have to think also in this earlier conversation, Iwan once told me, which I don't know if it's factually true, and at least spelling-wise it's also not true, but Louis Kahn said that there's the three Fs, finish it, photograph it, forget about it. Like for us, we let it also, you know, we let life take over, and I think Iwan does it very, very well. What we also sometimes do is just only look at, say, how social media, you know, how people in social media sort of absorb the building and just let it live.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much to the four of you for this conversation. I think I'm afraid we must leave so the next panel can take place. I would much rather stay and continue to talk. Thank you so much for this conversation.